W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Not So Black and White by Kenan Malik, narrated by Homer Todiwala. Introduction. Retelling the story of race. I cannot remember the first time I was beaten up because of my skin color. It was certainly before I reached my teens, but so normal was the experience of having to defend myself against racists that I have kept no mental tally. By the time I was a teenager, it was difficult to think of many days when I wasn't in a fight with racists. By the end of my teens, I was organizing street patrols to protect Asian families from racist attacks. The Britain in which I grew up in the 1970s was very different to the Britain of today. Racism was vicious and visceral and woven into the fabric of society in a way difficult to imagine now. Paki bashing was a national sport. Stabbings were common, firebombings almost routine events, and if you went to the police for aid, you were more likely to be arrested than the racists. It was that experience that drew me into political campaigns against street violence, police brutality, and racist deportations. But if it was racism that drew me to politics, it was politics that made me see beyond the narrow confines of racism. I came to learn that there was more to social justice than challenging the injustices done to me, and that a person's skin color, ethnicity, or culture provides no guide to the validity of his or her political beliefs. Through politics, I was introduced to the ideas of the Enlightenment and to the concepts of a common humanity and universal rights. Through politics, too, I discovered the writings of Karl Marx and John Stuart Mill, of Thomas Paine and Mary Wollstonecraft, of James Baldwin and Rosa Luxemburg, of C.L.R. James and Frantz Fanon, of Hannah Arendt and Sivanandan. Most of all, I discovered that I could often find more solidarity and commonality with those whose ethnicity or culture was different to mine, but who shared my values, than with many with whom I shared a common ethnicity or culture, but not the same political vision. My politics, in other words, was not shackled to my identity, but helped me to reach beyond it. It allowed me to see that my personal experiences and background were insufficient to help me formulate my values and ideals. It allowed me also to distinguish between identity and the politics of identity. Identities are of great significance to all of us. They give each of us a sense of ourselves, of our grounding in the world, and of our relationships to others. Politics, though, is a means, or should be a means, of taking us beyond the constricted sense of identity given to each of us by the specific circumstances of our lives and the particularities of personal experiences. I was able to unshackle my politics from my identity in large part because the struggles of British Asian communities at that time, organized through groups such as the Indian Workers Association and the Asian youth movements, were intimately bound up with wider struggles. Migrant workers were at the forefront of industrial action from the first significant post-war immigrant strike at Red Scar Mill near Preston, Lancashire, when Asian workers took action against the practice of forcing non-white workers to work more machines for less pay, to Grunwick, a photo processing plant in northwest London, where in 1976, 137, mainly Asian women, went on strike in protest at appalling conditions, racist intimidation, and the banning of unions. Within weeks of the Grunwick walkout, the women received support from other workers. Miners and electricians, builders and bus drivers joined mass pickets, 20,000 strong on one day, while postal workers refused to move the company's orders. Eventually, the trade union leadership withdrew its support, an act of betrayal that led to the women being defeated, ending their action after nearly 2 years. Devastating though the defeat was, The support from rank-and-file workers marked a significant moment in the struggle against racism and sexism, and in developing cross-racial working-class unity. This history provided the grounding for the struggles of my generation. We recognized, almost without thinking about it, the commonality of values, hopes, and aspirations that bound together Asians, blacks, and whites. If I was growing up in today's Britain, though, I'm not sure I would feel the same. Many of the organizations that allowed us to make those wider connections, such as the Asian youth movements, have disappeared. Countless groups in wider society that helped foster solidarity, whether within the anti-racist or the labor movements, have disintegrated too. Making those broader connections, seeing the bigger picture, breaking the shackles of identity, is more difficult today. Far from taking us beyond our narrow identities, contemporary politics is frequently circumscribed by them. In the past, the identities that defined us politically were often distinct from our personal identities. Today, they are regularly intertwined. Many imagine that to be Muslim, or white, or gay, or European, is to accept a particular package of values and beliefs and ideals. What we are defines what we should cherish or value or believe. Not So Black and White is a book about the history of the concept of race. It is also a book about the politics of identity. The two, as we shall see, are inextricably linked. To tell the story of one, we also have to tell the story of the other. Many imagine that identity politics is a new phenomenon, and one that is associated with the left. A long view reveals something different, that the origins of the politics of identity lie not on the left, but on the reactionary right. It developed in the late 18th century, and its primary expression was in the concept of race. Of course, it was not called identity politics then, but that is what it was. The concept of a racial type, as it developed through the 19th century, was a group of people linked by a set of fundamental characteristics and differing from other types by virtue of those attributes. These included not just mental and physical traits, but also social needs, aspirations, and value. One's being, one's identity, determined one's moral and social place in the world. Here was the original politics of identity. Today, the idea that one's beliefs, values, and social location is defined by one's identity is frequently found within anti-racist circles. Many anti-racists suggest that black or Asian people who are conservative or do not follow the set script of what minorities should believe or how they should behave are not really black or Asian, but straining to be white. Many demand that white artists or writers should not engage with black pain and insist that there are certain aspects of the histories and cultures of non-white groups that should be off limits to white intellectuals. I look more closely at these stay-in-your-lane arguments in Chapter 9. To understand why racists and identitarians often end up in the same place, we need to understand the complex relationship, both historical and contemporaneous, between racial beliefs and the politics of identity. That is what Not So Black and White sets out to do. There are four interwoven narratives in this book. The first is a retelling of the story of race. Most people assume that racism emerges when members of one race begin discriminating against members of another, that racism is what develops when races collide. I will show that historically the opposite is the case. Intellectuals and elites began dividing the world into distinct races to explain and justify the differential treatment of certain peoples. The ancestors of today's African Americans were not enslaved because they were black. They were eventually deemed to be black and a distinct race to justify their enslavement. What made justification necessary was that from the 18th century onwards, America, France, Britain, and other European nations began to define themselves by their attachment to equality and liberty. In practice, though, their policies denied both equality and liberty to much of the population. Race became the means to bridge the contradiction between the assertion that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, the claim of the American Declaration of Independence, and the reality of a slave-owning nation. The contradiction was waved away by insisting that certain people were by nature unequal and not deserving of liberty and equality. I retell the story of race in a different way, too. Today, we think about race primarily in terms of skin color or of continent of origin, black, white, Asian, and so on. But that was not how 19th century thinkers imagined race, which for them was a description of social inequality, not just of skin color. Certainly, they saw blacks and whites and Asians as distinct races, but they also often saw laborers and farmhands in the same way. It may be difficult to comprehend now, but 19th century thinkers looked upon the working class as a racial group, physically and anthropologically distinct from the rest of society, in much the same way as many now view black people as racially dissimilar to whites. Even in America, where slavery ensured that the black-white divide was paramount, other groups, European migrants, especially from Southern and Eastern Europe, Jews, sections of the working class and the poor, were racialized too. Understanding the real history of race is important not just as an intellectual exercise, but also because it challenges many of the ways in which we think about race and relations today. Interlaced with the history of race is my second story, that of the resistance to racism and colonialism, and of how that resistance expanded the meaning of equality and universality. Through the 20th century, and especially in the last decades, there developed an impassioned debate about the Enlightenment, and especially about the concept of universalism, which many came to see as Eurocentric, even racist. Both supporters and critics of the Enlightenment present it as a peculiarly European phenomenon. Both miss the importance of the non-European world in shaping many of the ideas we associate with the Enlightenment. It was, as we shall see, through the struggles of those denied equality and liberty by the elites in Europe and America, that ideas of universalism were invested with meaning. And it is the demise of that radical universalist tradition that has shaped much of what we now call identity politics. The third story is that of the relationship between race and class. In the age of Trump and Brexit, many of the left have come to despise the working class as racist, xenophobic, and ignorant. David Rothkopf, professor of international relations, CEO of Foreign Policy magazine, and a member of Bill Clinton's administration, described Trump supporters as people who are threatened by what they don't understand, and what they don't understand is almost everything. Many within the working class feel betrayed and abandoned by the liberal elites, rail against globalization and view migrants and minorities as threats to their livelihoods and social position. These are themes that have haunted the fractured relationships between different sections of workers from the 17th century onwards. I track some of the collisions between race and class, explore attempts to forge class unity across the fissures of race, and look at why the construction of cross-racial solidarity has proved so challenging. I also look at why the disproportionately working-class character of many black and minority communities makes for a more complex story than much of the discussion allows. Issues that on the surface seem straightforwardly as the product of racism, even ones as seemingly black and white as the shocking police killings of African Americans that gave rise to the Black Lives Matter movement, are, as I show in chapters 8 and 9, often better seen through the prism of class than of race. Our preoccupation with race frequently hides the realities of injustice. The final thread in my story is that of the emergence of modern identity politics. I look at the complex set of developments that has allowed it to occupy center stage, examine the relationship between modern identity politics and that of the past, and explore, too, the connections between the identitarianism of the left and that of the right. Woven into this history is also a critique of many of the concepts of contemporary left-wing identity politics, especially the understanding of whiteness and of white privilege, and of trends such as the calling out of cultural appropriation. This book is both narrow and expansive. It is narrow because the history it tells is largely a Western history, the story of race primarily in Western Europe and America. This is not because this is the only story I could tell. The history of the concept of race in China or Japan or Russia or India is important and fascinating, and some scholars have begun to sketch out such histories. Japan, as we shall see in Chapter 3, challenged ideas of white supremacy by introducing the ideal of equality into the debate in 1919 over the founding charter of the League of Nations. The Japan that talked of equality was also the Japan that imposed its own forms of national and racial superiority on subject peoples in East Asia. To have included these histories, however, would have made this book too unwieldy, and so they have been left out. In Western debates, I focus much on developments in America, especially in chapters 7, 8, and 9. This is not because I think that these are particularly insightful or significant in themselves. On the contrary, debates and policies in other parts of the world are too often unreflectingly shaped by ideas and movements that originated in America, whether 60s black power or the contemporary culture wars. That influence, underpinned by America's economic, political, and cultural weight, demands that we look even more carefully at those ideas and developments, unpack the myths, and unpick the arguments. And, in understanding the American debates, we understand more also about the debates beyond the USA. The focus on the American debates and on the black-white divide means that many Asian and Middle Eastern thinkers, from Sadiq al-Azam to Pankaj Mishra, and the specific debates in which they have been involved, are missing from the narrative. I recognize that this leaves a hole, but again, to have included those thinkers and those debates would have made the book too unmanageable. What I have tried to do is focus on those debates that most illuminate broader concerns. Not so black and white is narrow too, because it retells the history of race against the background of contemporary concerns, in particular, the debates over identity politics and the relationship between race and class. The themes I have picked out and the questions I have asked bear the stamp of those concerns. It is also expansive, though, because in retelling that story, not so black and white both questions the way we think about race and identity, and argues that to understand both issues, we have to take in a much broader social and political canvas. It shows how race is not simply a description of particular groups of people, but also a lens through which many themes of modernity have been brought into focus. Equality and inequality, progress and decay, the nature of class and of class politics, the social function of science, the meaning of radicalism, the character of capitalism, and the possibilities of social transformation. It is expansive too, because while it is a history of Western thought, it challenges the idea that Western thought can be understood simply by looking at Europe and America. To understand the Enlightenment, for instance, we have to understand the degree to which Enlightenment ideas, and in particular notions of equality and universalism, were subsequently shaped by intellectuals and movements from well beyond Europe and America, through their engagement with Euro-American ideas and their struggles against racial thinking and colonial rule. Part 1 of the book, The Barbarism of Race, tells the story of the rise of the concept of race and of white supremacy. Part 2, The Struggle to Transcend Race, of the development of movements against racism and their decay into contemporary identity politics. The chapters are both historical and conceptual. They often cover the same historical period, but tell a different narrative or look at it from a different perspective. Chapters 1 to 4 tell the story of the modern invention of, respectively, equality, race, whiteness, and antisemitism. They show how the coming of modernity transformed the ways in which people thought about human relationships, and how the Enlightenment embrace of equality as an ideal posed new questions about how to understand inequality and difference. It is in wrestling with the new conundrums thrown up by modernity, especially the tension between an abstract belief in equality and social practices that ensured not just inequality, but enslavement too, that concepts of race and of whiteness emerged. Chapter 5, the last chapter in Part 1, looks at Nazism and the Holocaust against the background of racism and colonialism. Hitler brought to Europe practices that Europeans had long pursued in their colonies. The result was both to unleash barbarism on a hitherto unimaginable scale in Europe, and to help undermine those practices, and the ideas from which they developed as their true consequences became clear. The post-Holocaust world looked upon race in a very different way. Part 2 explores the debates over universalism, the belief in the equal moral worth of all human beings, and in there being certain norms and forms of governance under which all humans best flourish. It shows the necessity of a universalist perspective in both building movements against racism and in transcending the very concept of race. It also shows the difficulties in constructing universalist movements, the divisions that have continually rent anti-racist and anti-colonial struggles, the obstacles to create solidarity across racial lines, and the constant temptation for anti-racists to mimic racial thinking by themselves adopting ideals and organizations rooted in racial categories. Chapter 6 begins with a discussion of the Haitian Revolution, one of the three major revolutions of the 18th century, but which, when compared to the place that the American and French revolutions occupy in our culture, is barely remembered. Yet, it was through the Haitian Revolution, in which the slaves of the French colony of Saint-Domingue dismantled their chains and declared an independent nation, that the emancipatory logic of the Declaration of the Rights of Man was for the first time seen through to its revolutionary conclusion. I look at the reverberations of the Haitian Revolution over the next two centuries, at how radical forms of universalism, inspired by Haiti, developed in contrast to a liberal universalism that tolerated slavery and welcomed colonialism, and at how the practices of racism and of imperialism posed great dilemmas for those combating them, creating new doubts about the Enlightenment that would flourish in the 20th century. Chapters 7, 8, and 9, all of which focus on developments in America, look at how the promise of universalism became degraded. Chapter 7 tracks the fraught relationship between the battles for black emancipation and working class struggles, and of the attempts to sustain a universalist vision in the face of opposition from both without and within. Chapter 8 tells of the long arc of the struggle for black rights in 20th century America, and at how early attempts to forge unity between black and working class struggles foundered, how the battles for economic and for political equality became separated, and how, in the process, black identity was remade. It is a story that takes us from the case of the Scottsboro Boys, nine black teenagers fitted up for rape, who would probably have gone to the electric chair but for the extraordinary intervention of the Communist Party through the Black Power movement of the 1960s to Black Lives Matter. Chapter 9 looks at how the endpoint of these developments was the emergence of identity politics. It looks at the complex set of changes in the post-war world that nurtured the politics of identity, and it casts a skeptical eye on issues such as critical race theory, cultural appropriation, and white privilege. Finally, Chapter 10 shows how the identity politics of the left allowed racist ideas to be rebranded as white identity. It brings us almost full circle as the reactionary right, marginalized in the post-war world because of its rootedness in pre-war racial thinking, has been able to reclaim its original heritage. Chapter 10 examines how the far right has exploited the language of pluralism and diversity to remake racial ideas. It looks, too, at how mainstream conservatives have helped rehabilitate some of the most vicious messages of reactionary identitarians. The chapter, and the book, ends with a reflection on how to escape the identitarian trap and uncage ourselves from our obsession with race. We live in an age in which in most societies there is a moral abhorrence of racism, albeit that in most bigotry and discrimination still disfigure the lives of many. We also live in an age in which our thinking is saturated with racial ideology and the embrace of difference. The more we despise racial thinking, the more we cling to it. It is like an ideological version of the Stockholm syndrome. Not so black and white does not provide a ready-made cure for the syndrome. I hope, though, I can show how we have ended up where we are, and in understanding that, we can understand also how to release ourselves from our fetters of both race and identity. 1. The invention of equality. 1. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. It's a line that every American knows as intimately as their phone number, and one that millions across the globe recognize. A line from the American Declaration of Independence that declares the founding of a nation on an eternal, inviolable principle. Except, there is nothing either eternal or inviolable about that principle. The idea that all men are created equal may seem unexceptional today. Belief in equality and in a common humanity oxygenates the bloodstream of the modern world. And yet, at the time it was written, in 1776, the sentiment was anything but self-evident. So extraordinary was it that even those who wrote that line and signed the declaration did not accept it. They held it self-evident that all men were equal, but also held slaves. Not till almost a century after the Declaration was slavery formally abolished with the passing of the 13th Amendment in 1865. Not till 3 years later, with the 14th Amendment, were African Americans deemed constitutionally to be American citizens. And not till 1870 were they afforded the constitutional, though not necessarily the actual, right to vote, when the 15th Amendment guaranteed citizens the right to vote irrespective of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. For the men who signed the Declaration of Independence, and for those who subsequently framed the American Constitution, all men clearly meant all white men, or more precisely, all propertied white men. We can read this as revealing the gross hypocrisy of America's founding fathers and the degree to which notions of liberty were racially stained. How is it, as Samuel Johnson asked, that we hear the loudest yelps for liberty among the drivers of Negroes? We can also read it, however, as showing how remarkable is the claim that all men are created equal, and how difficult it has proved historically to turn that sentiment into social practice. Today, equality may be the default setting, as Dutch historian Siep Sturman puts it, and inequality acceptable only to the extent that it is justified by good reasons. For virtually the whole of human history, however, the reverse held. Inequality was the habitual and reasonable standard, while equality stood in need of justification if it was considered at all. Inequality was omnipresent, palpable, and realistic, while equality had to be imagined, argued for, conjured up from nowhere. Equality had to be invented. Concepts of equality and of common humanity run deep into human history. We find whispers in ancient China and ancient Greece, in Buddhism and Stoicism, and stronger echoes within the monotheistic faiths. In the pre-modern world, such ideas were relatively marginal and cut against the grain of social reality. Even those few individuals who dared to dream about equality mostly accepted the reality of societies steeped in hierarchy and difference. It was not till the Enlightenment movement in the 18th century that the modern concept of equality was nurtured. The Enlightenment was also the period in which modern racial theories began to surface. In the decades between the American Revolution of 1776 and the European Revolutions of 1848, the concept of race moved into mainstream thinking and became the principal lens through which Western societies viewed social differences. This paradox of modernity as the age that invented the concepts both of equality and of race still shapes our consciousness today. It is the paradox at the heart of this book. The common sense view of racial inequality is that certain people are treated unequally because they belong to or are seen as belonging to distinct races. African Americans or British Asians face discrimination because they are viewed as racially distinct. Our tendency to categorize people by race and to infer different qualities in different races has led to racial inequality. The trouble with this argument is that race, like equality, is a social, not a natural concept. It, too, had to be invented. If there is nothing natural about races, why do some societies feel compelled to categorize people by race? To answer that, we need to turn the common sense argument on its head. It is not racial differences that have led to unequal treatment, but the persistence of social inequalities in societies with a commitment to equality that has led many to view such inequalities as ineradicable, and hence natural, and to place people into different racial categories. Race did not give birth to racism. Racism gave birth to race. 2. The axis of world history, the most deep-cut dividing line in history, lay, the 20th-century German philosopher and theologian Karl Jaspers claimed, in the centuries between 800 and 200 BCE, the period in which man as we know him today came into being. What Jaspers called the Axial Age was indeed a transformative moment in the great civilizational centers across the globe. In China and India, in Greece and Palestine and Persia, the old heroic age, in which human lives and moral conduct were shaped largely by myth and legend, whether the Iliad and the Odyssey in Greece or the Mahabharata and Ramayana in India, gave way to a more philosophical, self-reflective time. New philosophies, faiths, and moral ideas were seeded, from Judaism in Israel to the teachings of Zoroaster in Persia, the rise of Confucianism and Maoism in China, the advent of Buddhism and the creation of the Upanishads in India, to the Socratic tradition in Greece. In these philosophies was first grasped the idea of the human in a more universal sense, and the possibilities of equality glimpsed. Perhaps the earliest expression of a common humanity was in the work of one of China's forgotten philosophers, Mo Tzu, who lived in the 5th century BCE, and whose influence at the time vied with that of Confucius. At the heart of his philosophy was the insistence that the well-being of strangers should concern us as much as those of our family, that one should regard others' states as though regarding one's state, regarding others' families as though regarding one's family, and regard other persons as though regarding one's person. It was a remarkable argument to make 2,500 years ago, centuries before similar ideas began to develop within Greek and Christian traditions. In the 2nd century CE, the Greek Stoic philosopher Heracles imagined in his Elements of Ethics every human as standing at the center of a series of concentric circles. The first circle was the individual. Next came the family, the local community, the country, and finally, all of humanity. To be virtuous, Heracles argued, was to draw these circles together, constantly transferring people from the outer to the inner bounds, treating strangers as cousins and cousins as siblings, making all humans part of our concern. The Stoics called this process of drawing the circles together oikeosis, an almost untranslatable word, but which means something like the process by which everything is made into your home. For all such early claims, it is in Christianity that many find the origins of the universalism underlying much modern secular thinking. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female. For you, all are one in Jesus Christ. So wrote Paul, seen by many modern Christian thinkers as the man who laid the philosophical foundations of their faith, preaching, in the words of historian Tom Holland, of a deity who recognized no borders, no divisions, except the deity did. Those that did not take shelter in the body of Christ were barred not just from the kingdom of heaven, but often from universal brotherhood on earth too. Well into the early modern period, there were debates as to whether non-Christians were to be seen as fellow human beings, whether they possessed souls. It was also a form of universalism that appeared not to apply to the everyday life of the present world. From the beginning, the historian of Christianity Dermot McCullough observes, there was an acknowledgement that Christianity was not going to make a radical challenge to existing social distinctions. Status and hierarchy, inequality and privilege, were all to stay. Each one should remain in the condition in which he was called, as Paul himself put it. Most strikingly, virtually every Christian thinker until modern times accepted the legitimacy of slavery. The tension between preaching about human brotherhood and accepting the institution of servitude was neatly resolved in Christian theology. Robert Fogel observes, by treating slavery as a condition of the body rather than of the spirit, in the spiritual realm, all men were brothers in union with God. But in the temporal realm, slavery was a necessary part of the world of sin. Augustine, a Roman citizen born to a Berber family in North Africa in the 4th century CE, became perhaps the greatest of all Christian theologians. Slavery, he insisted, was ordained by God's law, which demanded the preservation of the order of nature and forbids its disruption. Jesus did not say to slaves, "Get rid of your master," but rather, "Be a slave." The cries of those who opposed slavery fell like seed among thorns in Holland's evocative words. At the dawn of the modern world, even those Christians self-consciously committed to equality accepted the necessity for, even legitimacy of, slavery. The Religious Society of Friends, the Quakers, emerged from the ferment of the English Civil Wars, 1642 to 51, as one of the most egalitarian of Christian denominations. They are celebrated as the pioneers of abolitionism. Quaker voices against slavery were, however, a minority until the second half of the 18th century. There were Quaker planters in the West Indies and Quaker slave merchants in London. One early critic of slavery, Benjamin Lay, tells the story of his wife Sarah visiting a fellow Quaker in Barbados in 1718. The couple have recently arrived on the island from England. She was shocked to find outside the house a hung-up Negro stark naked, trembling and shivering, with such a flood of blood under him. The Quaker owner, with no sense of embarrassment that this might be a morally repugnant act, explained that it was punishment for absconding a day or two. Not until the latter decades of the 18th century did Quakers and other Christians turn decisively against slavery. Radical anti-slavery, Robin Blackburn observes, required the existence of a secular public space and a willingness to challenge the established social order. It required, too, a new concept of equality and of a common humanity. 3. There is perhaps no period of history that has been more analyzed, debated, celebrated, and disparaged than the Enlightenment. An intellectual wind of change that blew through 18th century Europe, placing great store on reason and tolerance, and helping reset the meanings of concepts such as humanity, equality, and democracy. It is not simply a historical moment, but one through which controversies about the contemporary world are played out. From the role of science to the war on terror, from free speech to racism, there are few debates today that do not engage with the Enlightenment, or at least with what we imagine the Enlightenment to have been. Inevitably, the imagining of the Enlightenment has become a historical battleground. The story of the Enlightenment, of what it was and how it developed, began to be written by Enlightenment philosophers themselves. Immanuel Kant, in his essay, What is Enlightenment?, answered that it was man's release from his self-incurred tutelage. Humanity had enchained itself through its own ignorance. Enlightenment thinkers had set it free by allowing the light of reason to shine upon human problems. This was, of course, a self-serving definition, one that airily dismissed pre-Enlightenment intellectual traditions upon which Kant and his fellow philosophers drew and was blind to the ignorance and unreason of many Enlightenment thinkers themselves. Yet, it also gave a sense of the historical significance of the era. That significance has been challenged over the past century from different perspectives. Some historians developed national rather than pan-European accounts of the Enlightenment. The French Enlightenment, the German Enlightenment, the Scottish Enlightenment, each to be analyzed in its own terms, often as a display of national pride. Others have stressed the social and cultural rather than intellectual aspects of the period, questioning, in the words of Robert Darnton, the overly highbrow, overly metaphysical view of intellectual life in the 18th century. A third group of scholars challenged the very idea of the Enlightenment as a good. In 1944, in the shadow of Auschwitz, Theodor Adorno and Max Horkheimer, key members of the Frankfurt School, published their seminal work, Dialectic of Enlightenment. Like many radicals of the time, they asked themselves why it was that Germany, a nation with deep philosophical roots in the Enlightenment, should succumb so quickly and so completely to Nazism. The answer seemed to lie in the character of Enlightenment thought itself. Adorno and Horkheimer did not reject the Enlightenment in its entirety, but they saw it as not only lighting the way to emancipation, but also as enabling the darkness of the Holocaust. In recent decades, this skepticism has been nurtured within postmodern and postcolonial theory. Enlightenment, rationalism, and universalism, long seen as the foundation stones of progressive belief, are now, as we shall see in Chapter 9, often dismissed as Eurocentric, even racist. Conflicts between these various interpretations have been exacerbated by the culture wars. One's attitude to the Enlightenment has come to mark one's place on the culture war map. On the one side are those who imagine that to be critical of the Enlightenment is not to believe in science and reason. On the other, many suggest that to defend the Enlightenment is to defend racism and imperialism. As in many such debates, there are elements of truth on both sides. One theme of this book is the need to comprehend both the immense significance of the Enlightenment and the depth of the contradictions and paradoxes that rent it. From one perspective, what defined the Enlightenment was not a specific set of ideas, but a questioning attitude. Even Michel Foucault, one of its sternest postmodern critics, acknowledged that the thread that may connect us with the Enlightenment is a philosophical ethos that could be described as a permanent critique of our historical era. Beyond this attitude were also several philosophical themes, which, while often fiercely contested, nevertheless provided a thread through much of the Enlightenment. The two most important motifs were the moral significance of equality and of a common human nature. Hand-me-downs from religious, especially Christian thought, they were remade in the 18th century. It is universally acknowledged, the Scottish philosopher David Hume wrote, that there is a great uniformity among the acts of men in all nations and all ages, and that human nature remains the same in its principles and operations. Similarly, the French philosopher Denis Diderot argued that manners or habits are not African or Asiatic or European. They are good or bad. There are slaves under the pole where it is very cold, and a slave in Constantinople where it is very hot. But everywhere a people should be educated, free, and virtuous. Linked to the belief in a common human nature and in universal values was the idea of equality. If we would indicate an idea which throughout the whole course of history has ever more and more widely extended its empire, wrote the Prussian philosopher, linguist, and diplomat Wilhelm von Humboldt, 1767 to 1835, it is that of establishing our common humanity, of striving to remove the barriers which prejudice and limited views of every kind have erected among men, and to treat all mankind without reference to religion, nation, or color, as one fraternity, one great community. Von Humboldt expresses here beautifully the link, as many Enlightenment philosophers saw it, between the concept of a common humanity and that of equality, of treating all mankind without reference to religion, nation, or color. The link was not, however, straightforward. The idea of equality required belief in a common humanity, but belief in a common humanity did not necessarily lead to an acceptance of equality, either as an ideal or as a practical possibility. That it did so in the minds of 18th century European philosophers was in many ways remarkable. In a Europe long dominated by kings, princes, and nobles, saturated in the culture of courts and courtiers, the historian Jonathan Israel observes, to speak of fundamental equality must have seemed to be going against the grain of reality, to be lost in chimeras. If the Axial Age was the first great turning point in human history, Zeep Sturman suggests, the Enlightenment represents the second. It radically changed the terms of the debate about common humanity and cultural difference. Henceforth, equality received the benefit of the doubt, while inequality had to be justified by rational argument. Enlightenment philosophers drew upon the claims of religious groups from the radical wing of the Reformation, groups such as the Levellers and the Diggers in England, who emerged through the civil wars, or the Anabaptists in the Low Countries and German-speaking lands. These groups all had different beliefs, but were linked by a commitment to equality and democracy. Their Protestantism stood opposed not just to the Catholic Church, but also to the Protestantism of mainstream leaders, such as Martin Luther and John Calvin. The magisterial reformation directed by such leaders was intensely conservative, appealing to monarchs and princes chafing at the constraints imposed by papal power, but having no desire to create a more equal society. When in 1524, German peasants revolted against oppressive taxes and laws, demanding the end to serfdom and the right to use common fields, forests, and waters, it was championed by poorer clergy, but condemned by mainstream clerics. Luther defended the slaughter of thousands in a brutal crackdown by the authorities on the grounds that the peasants had become faithless, perjured, disobedient, rebellious murderers, robbers, and blasphemers, whom even a heathen ruler has the right and authority to punish. Luther and the radicals read the same Bible, were equally hostile to the doctrines of the Catholic Church, and were both adamant that faith was a matter of an individual's relationship with God unmediated by religious institutions. But these religious beliefs were given different meanings by distinct social and political views. What was essential to radical egalitarianism was not religious doctrine, but political vision. The vision upon which Enlightenment philosophers drew, and which they transformed into a defining principle. 4. And yet, it is not so straightforward. Samuel Johnson's rhetorical question about American revolutionaries: how is it that we hear the loudest yelps for liberty among the drivers of Negroes? Can be asked also of Enlightenment philosophers. Many combined a defense of liberty and equality with profoundly racist attitudes. Consider three of the most influential Enlightenment thinkers: David Hume, Immanuel Kant, and Thomas Jefferson. David Hume, 1711-76, the leading light of the Scottish Enlightenment, whose naturalism, skepticism, and moral theories have been highly influential, was a strong opponent of slavery, but nevertheless helped his patron Lord Hertford buy a slave plantation in Grenada. He argued that human nature remains the same in its principles and operations, but also that "I am apt to suspect the Negroes to be naturally inferior to the whites." The uniform and constant difference between whites and blacks, he insisted, could not happen, if nature had not made an original distinction between these breeds of men. Immanuel Kant, 1724-1804, is the towering figure of the Enlightenment. He synthesized rationalism and empiricism, setting the terms for much subsequent philosophy, and continues to exercise significant influence in a swathe of philosophical disciplines, from metaphysics to ethics. Kant was also an important figure in the development of racial theory. Between 1775 and 1788, he published three major works that engaged directly with the question of racial difference. For Kant, humanity comprised one species but four races: whites, blacks, Hindustanic, and Kalmuck, distinguished primarily by skin color. The original human stock contained seeds that predisposed them to particular racial qualities, mental and physical, but which expressed themselves only in certain climactic or geographical conditions. Once the four basic types had emerged, they remained permanently fixed and could not further change. This allowed Kant to maintain both that human populations could change and that races were fixed. Kant not only established a taxonomy of race, but also imposed value judgments upon them. "Humanity," he wrote, "has its greatest degree of perfection in the white race. The yellow Indians have a somewhat lesser talent. The Negroes are much lower, and the lowest of all is part of the Native American peoples. According to Kant, the race of the American cannot be educated because it lacks effect and passion, while Negroes can be educated but only as servants, slaves. The Moors, he believed, like all inhabitants of the hot zones, have a thick skin. When one disciplines them, one cannot hit them with sticks, but rather whip with split canes, so that the blood finds a way out and does not suppurate under the skin. Across the Atlantic, Thomas Jefferson wrote in 1787 of African slaves that they have been liberally educated and all have lived in countries where the arts and sciences have been cultivated to a considerable degree. Still, never yet could I find that a black has uttered a thought above the level of plain narration, never seen even an elementary trait of painting or sculpture. The condition of Roman slaves, who were of the race of whites, was much more deplorable than that of blacks on the continent of America. They had, nevertheless, often been the rarest of artists, and had excelled too in science. It is not their condition, then, but nature, Jefferson suggested, which has produced their distinction. How can we reconcile the views of Hume, Kant, and Jefferson with those of Humboldt and Diderot, and with the Enlightenment's attachment to equality? Many scholars believe we cannot. The late philosopher Charles Mills argued that for the Enlightenment thinkers, whiteness was a prerequisite for personhood, and therefore a necessary quality to be deserving of equality. Non-whites were limited to subperson status. Far from there being a contradiction between Enlightenment ideas of equality and the claims about racial differences, the two are fully compatible because egalitarian theory's terms were never meant to be extended generally outside the European population. Similarly, Emmanuel Eze observes that in Enlightenment writings, reason and civilization became almost synonymous with white people in Northern Europe, while unreason and savagery were conveniently located among the non-whites, the black, the red, the yellow, outside Europe. The Enlightenment should be seen not as the source of modern ideas of equality, but as the cradle of racism, helping articulate Europe's sense not only of its cultural, but also racial superiority. If Mills and Eze are right, we would have to rethink our whole approach to the idea of equality in Enlightenment, indeed, to the very idea of equality in the modern world. But are they right? 5. Paris, 25th of May, 1781. The Palais de la Cité, a magnificent cluster of buildings on the Isle de la Cité, home to the kings of France from the 6th to the 14th centuries, it now housed the treasury, the courts of justice, and the Parlement de Paris, a judicial, not legislative body. A crowd had gathered, and there, at the bottom of the splendid staircase that swept down from the Parlement, the public hangman was getting ready for work, to flog and to burn. Only on this day, the victim was not a human, but a book. It was not uncommon for forbidden books to be publicly burnt in pre-revolutionary France. It was, though, a special book the hangman held in his hands on that particular day. The Histoire philosophique et politique des établissements et du commerce des Européens dans les deux Indes, more commonly known as Histoire des deux Indes, History of the Two Indies. It was among the most read 18th century books, with 30 underground editions in France, and many foreign translations. There were 20 English editions alone. Originally published anonymously in 1770, the work came to be associated with Guillaume Thomas François Raynal, a former priest. It was banned by the French government and placed on the Catholic Church's Index Librorum Prohibitorum, its list of forbidden books. The third, and much expanded edition published in 1780 in Geneva, caused the greatest outrage. The Parlement labelled the work impious, blasphemous, seditious, tending to incite people against rightful authority, and ordered its incineration. Raynal was forced into exile, narrowly escaping imprisonment. The Histoire was not an easy read. The 1780 edition was a four-volume work of more than 3,000 pages, stuffed full of statistics and tables. How did it become such a bestseller? And why was it considered so dangerous? The Histoire was an excoriation of European slavery and colonialism. The work of several authors, it has an uneven, sometimes contradictory character, with mainstream views jostling with radical sentiments. The radicalism was infused primarily by Denis Diderot, 1713-84, whom some believe contributed almost a third of the 1780 edition. Like Raynal, Diderot trained initially for the priesthood in a Jesuit college, but almost immediately abandoned the church for a different kind of contemplative life, that of a writer. Disowned by his father, he made his way to Paris, where he lived a bohemian existence, always at the edge of poverty, yet became one of the most significant figures in the Enlightenment. His most remarkable achievement was the 28-volume Encyclopédie, which he created and edited with mathematician and philosopher Jean-Baptiste Leron d'Alembert. Its goal was to assemble all the knowledge scattered on the surface of the earth, and in doing so, change men's common way of thinking. Perhaps even more than the Encyclopédie, it was the Histoire that achieved that latter aim. The two Indies of the title referred to the Americas and the Caribbean islands, to the west and to India and much of Asia, to the east. The book was a history of European exploration and conquest since the 15th century, combining quantitative data about trade and the world's material resources, and a panegyric to commerce, with a devastating denunciation of European colonialism. At its heart lay Diderot's moral universalism, his insistence that all humans possess the same needs, pleasures, pains, strengths, and weaknesses, and so are entitled to the same dignity, justice, and consideration. European colonialists, Diderot argues, had no sense that different societies' common needs could be expressed in different ways. Any society unlike those of Europe was taken to be backward or unworthy of respect. The indigenous peoples of Mexico had created complex and highly structured societies, but the Spanish conquistadors fancied that these people had no form of government because it was not vested in a single person. No civilization because it differed from that of Madrid, no virtues because they were not of the same religious persuasion, and no understanding because they did not adopt the same opinion. So blind were they to the lives of others that they would have been inclined to consider Athens in the same contentious light. Europeans' insatiable thirst for gold, Diderot argues, has given birth to the most infamous and atrocious of all trades, that of slaves. The majority of European nations are soiled by it, and a vile self-interest has stifled in human hearts all the feelings we owe to our fellow men. Colonialism, too, had brought little but disaster, as ruins have been heaped upon ruins, and vast tracts cemented with blood. Whether writing of the Spanish in the Americas, the French in the Caribbean, or the English in India, Diderot is equally abrasive. He is not, he insists, being a moral relativist. He does not prefer a savage to a civilized state. But as he asks of the arrival of the conquistadors in the Americas, tell me, reader, do you see here civilized people arriving among savages? or savages received by civilized people. If the writings of Hume, Kant, and Jefferson represent one strand of the Enlightenment thinking about race and equality, the Histoire des deux Indes represents another. These two distinct strands, the moderate and the radical, and the struggle between them, were key in shaping the character of the Enlightenment and of the post-Enlightenment world, and in framing subsequent debates about race, colonialism, and identity. The idea of the radical Enlightenment remains contested among historians. Nevertheless, it is a useful way of looking at 18th-century debates, and at the paradox of an age which helped establish modern ideas of both equality and racial inequality. The radical Enlightenment comprised not so much a fixed group as an approach to questions of democracy and equality, secularism and progress, an approach whose meaning was often fiercely debated by the radicals, but one that, for all the variety of perspectives, was fundamentally distinct from that of the mainstream. The mainstream Enlightenment consisted of the figures with whom we are most familiar and about whom historians have most written. Not just Kant, Hume, and Jefferson, but also Locke and Voltaire, Adam Smith and Benjamin Franklin. It was, however, the radical Enlightenment, shaped by lesser-known figures such as D'Holbach, Diderot, and Spinoza, that endowed the Enlightenment with its heart and soul. Where the mainstream sought to modify and effect repairs to the old structure, given us by divine providence and hence basically good, argues Jonathan Israel, the radicals strove to tear the old house of Ancien Régime society down and put another in its place. Many of the mainstream philosophers possessed rich patrons and official posts. The radicals operated largely in clandestine groups. The great names of the French Enlightenment, Voltaire, Montesquieu, and Turgot, gathered in salons in splendid houses and in grand cafes. The lesser figures congregated in the seediest of taverns, where one only finds pimps, buggers, and burdash. To quote the notorious blackmailer and police spy, Charles-Claude Devenue. They produced illicit pamphlets printed by hidden presses and sold, in the words of Philippe Blom, sous le manteau, under the cloak, as secretly and often as expensively as hard drugs today, and with the same risk of being arrested and imprisoned. These pamphlets ranged from pornographic stories to atheist tracts. What they had in common was their challenge to conventional norms, and that they were forbidden. It was in these taverns and in these pamphlets, among the pornographers and the pimps, that the radical Enlightenment first found its voice. It was where Diderot began his intellectual life, before eventually graduating to the grand salons. It was here, too, that ideas and concepts that have helped make the modern world first saw the light. While the great figures of the French Enlightenment grew fat in Voltaire's church, Robert Danton observes, the revolutionary spirit passed to the lean and hungry men of Grub Street, to the cultural pariahs who hated the old regime in their guts, who ached with the hatred of it. The two most subversive themes in the underground pamphlets were the insistence on a godless universe and a radical vision of equality. Two themes that became inextricably linked. It was not that the radicals were all atheists. Not only were there many believers with varying degrees of faith, but the roots of the radical Enlightenment lay, at least partly, in the religious movements that formed the revolutionary edge of the Reformation. But Christianity itself was changing. From the late Middle Ages, there had developed within the Christian tradition a new humanist sensibility, as well as a greater willingness to accept a more naturalistic view and a growing desire to root faith in reason. The radical Enlightenment pushed these arguments much further. For the radicals, to be human meant to have the power and capacity to be master of one's own destiny, independently of divine intervention. whereas for previous generations, nature made sense as God's order. Many philosophers now insisted that only humans infused it with meaning. The universe is dumb, Diderot declared. It is only the presence of man that gives interest to the existence of beings. As the God-ordained order crumbled, so the argument for equality became both more necessary and more possible. Having dispensed with God, the radicals had, in Jonathan Israel's words, no meaningful alternative to articulating a new view of the human in which morality was grounded in a generalized radical egalitarianism extended across all frontiers, class barriers, and horizons. Egalitarianism became the moral anchor for radicalism and would continue to be well beyond the Enlightenment. It was, ironically, in the fracturing of the God-ordained order that the moral universalism implicit in Christianity could become manifest. 6. On the morning of the 28th of October 1647, a group of soldiers met at St. Mary's Church in Putney, in southwest London. They had come not to pray, nor to fight, but to partake in what might seem a very unsoldierly act, a political debate among the most momentous in British history. All were regulars in the new model army, the most radical and significant of the parliamentary forces waging war against Charles I in the English civil wars that rent the nation through the 1640s. The army had been established in 1645 as a body of professional soldiers committed to the parliamentary cause and possessed an extraordinary degree of internal democracy. Every regiment voted on representatives, called agitators, for an army council, and ordinary soldiers were vocal in their political opinions. The issue at stake in what are now called the Putney debates was the nature of England's constitution once Charles had been defeated. Dismayed by the timidity of the army officers' proposals, which would have retained the monarchy, rank-and-file soldiers produced their own constitutional plan. An agreement of the people was written largely by levellers, the name given by their enemies to a disparate movement of radicals who believed that all degrees of men should be levelled and an equality should be established. The document called for biennial parliamentary elections, for the rule of law to apply equally to everyone without reference to tenure, estate, charter, degree, birth, or place, and for freedom of speech and worship. The poorest he that is in England hath a life to live as the greatest he, argued Colonel Thomas Rainsborough, speaking for the radicals, and therefore, every man that is to live under a government ought first by his own consent to put himself under that government. The levellers were not calling for universal suffrage. Under their proposal, women, servants and paupers would be denied the vote. It took more radical groups, such as the diggers, to argue for full suffrage. Nevertheless, it was still too far-reaching for the grandees, or officer class. Liberty, as Henry Ireton, a general in the army, and Oliver Cromwell's son-in-law put it in the debate, cannot be provided for in a general sense if property be preserved. What worried the grandees was that, in the words of Colonel Nathaniel Rich, if the master and servant be equal electors, then there may be a law enacted that there shall be an equality of goods and estate. To preserve the right to property, equality must be constrained, and Ireton insisted the vote must be restricted to persons in whom all land lies, and those in corporations in whom all trading lies. In response to which Rainsborough acidly asked, I am a poor man, therefore I must be oppressed. This tension between equality and property is one that shaped much subsequent history, particularly the Enlightenment battle between the moderates and the radicals. The birth of modernity embodied a series of tensions that were and remain unresolved. In the latter decades of the 18th century, those tensions exploded to create what we now call the Age of Revolution, an age in which the old order, the ancien régime unraveled. From those tensions emerged also the paradox of an age that laid the modern foundations both of equality and of inequality. Between the 16th and 18th centuries, a series of social and economic changes paved the way for modernity. The creation of more individualized societies, the beginning of a market economy, and of novel forms of manufacture, the emergence of new social forces, from the nascent bourgeoisie to the even more nascent working class. From the perspective of the 21st century, though, the 18th century world seems more feudal than modern. There had been steady economic growth since the early 1600s. Nevertheless, Europe remained overwhelmingly rural, and life for the majority continued to be parochial, fragmented, and inward-looking. Of the new entrepreneurial class, the key figures were the merchant, the financier, and the colonial planter, not yet the industrialist. Nation-states barely existed in the modern sense. Europe was a patchwork of empires, kingdoms, duchies, and papal states, mostly ruled, with the exception of Britain, by absolute monarchs. Below them were hierarchies of landed nobles. Buttressing the whole system was an orthodoxy of churches and a clutter of institutions whose power seemed to derive from their very obsolescence. Enlightenment philosophers aimed to free humanity from the grip of tradition and unreason, to abolish archaic institutions based on prescription, and to establish society on a more rational foundation. It was the philosophy primarily of the embryonic bourgeoisie, of merchants and financiers, of intellectuals and artisans, whose aspirations to economic, political, and social power required the undermining of feudal institutions. But those who were, in Hume's words, placed in the middle station of life lacked the social means to effect change. A relationship developed, therefore, between the educated classes and old rulers. A prince needed the middle class and its ideas to modernize his state, Eric Hobsbawm observed. A weak middle class needed a prince to batter down the resistance of entrenched aristocratic and clerical reaction to progress. Enlightenment ideals appealed, however, not just to rulers who wanted a more rational ancien régime, or to a middle class that wanted a society sufficiently reformed to afford it power. They appealed, too, to those who wanted more profound changes. There were bourgeois radicals such as the American patriots who sought to break free from the claims of political oligarchy, waging a revolution to create a more democratic system. But those same revolutionaries wished also to limit the claims of equality, denying the most basic of rights to slaves, free blacks, women, and workers. These were the groups, the poor, the dispossessed, the enslaved, who pushed the implicit logic of Enlightenment claims about equality and a common humanity to their conclusion, who recognized to make good on these claims, a fundamental transformation of society was necessary. It was, as we shall see in later chapters, through the struggles of slaves to emancipate themselves, of colonial subjects challenging imperial rule, of the working class demanding decent wages and conditions, of women claiming the right to vote, that the idea of equality was given a fuller meaning. All this only made moderates more fearful of the social consequences of equality. The conundrum they faced is well expressed in the work of Adam Smith. Moral philosopher and political economist, Smith's two great works, The Theory of Moral Sentiments and The Wealth of Nations, published in 1759 and 1776 respectively, spoke to the two sides of the challenge facing the moderates. The Wealth of Nations made the case for a free market economy and for the invisible hand of the market as the means to social equity. The Theory of Moral Sentiments, written 17 years earlier, recognized the importance of sympathy in social life and the necessity of an equitable society. It was not that the two books stood opposed to each other. It was rather that in both were exposed the moderate's dilemma. Every individual, Smith wrote in The Wealth of Nations, exploits his capital in a fashion most advantageous to himself. But the study of his own advantage necessarily leads him to prefer that employment of capital which is most advantageous to the society. The rich are led by an invisible hand to make nearly the same distribution of the necessaries of life which would have been made had the earth been divided into equal portions among all its inhabitants. Despite the division of society into rich and poor, the market ensured as great a degree of equality as if such equality had been enforced by the mandatory redistribution of wealth. And yet, it was not so simple. The disposition to admire and almost to worship the rich and the powerful, and to despise or at least to neglect persons of poor and mean condition, Smith wrote in The Theory of Moral Sentiments, is necessary both to establish and to maintain the distinction of ranks in the order of society, but is, at the same time, the great and most universal cause of the corruption of our moral sentiments. Maintaining the distinction of ranks was corrupting because inequality was not a social good. No society, Smith observed, can surely be flourishing and happy, of which the far greater part of the members are poor and miserable. Nevertheless, it was necessary because inequality was a driver of social and economic growth. The existence of the rich led the poor to work harder to achieve what they did not have. This meant that wherever there is great property, there is great inequality, and the affluence of the rich excites the indignation of the poor. Since the rich man is at all times surrounded by unknown enemies, so he necessarily must be protected by the powerful arm of the civil magistrate, continually held up to chastise it. Smith accepted the ideal of equality in the abstract. That is, he acknowledged that at some level all human beings were of equal moral worth. He recognized, too, that too much inequality was not a social good. Nevertheless, he also thought it necessary to maintain the distinction of ranks. In other words, inequality, without which there could be no economic or social progress. The philosopher and historian Adam Ferguson, a fellow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.